Thank you. That was quite nice. Quite nice. I appreciate that. We have now made it to the tutors. And as you know, there is quite a bit out there about the tutors and quite a bit that you probably know your very self. So forgive me if I am repeating in some cases information that is very familiar to you. Why are we so fascinated by the tutors? I guess is the first issue. First of all, I think it's because most of us don't realize, but this dynasty actually ruled only a century. And yet, this period, the 16th century, was a time of some of the most momentous changes and developments in the history of what became the United Kingdom. I refer, of course, to the fact that during this particular time, England embarked on its colonial empire. It enjoyed or experienced the Protestant Reformation and the development of the Church of England. We also know, of course, that among the rulers of this dynasty were some of the most interesting and remarkable people, including not only the obvious, Henry VIII and Elizabeth, but also the individual from whom we got the delightful morning drink, the Bloody Mary. So just bear that in mind. Tudor culture is around us in so many ways. Now, if it is true that the red and white were the symbols of those Wars of the Roses, then, as you see, symbolically speaking, the Tudors were represented by the two flowers coming together. And, of course, there is a reason for that in terms of families. The union of Henry with the daughter of a family that I just talked about this morning, those Woodvilles. Elizabeth Woodville and her husband, the King Edward IV. This marriage, whether it was based on love, was certainly an important one. And Elizabeth, who may or may not have had other interests. I mean, she was a wonderful queen. She did a lot of great things. But this is whom she married. Now, if you remember this from the play Richard III, it's all there. Everybody's just so happy and all of that. Now, you have to wonder what must have been in her mind. But she was a good wife, and we will see that their children, two sons and two daughters, will have, in their own times, illustrious careers of sorts. And at the same time, his claims will be strengthened, even though I wouldn't have brought up that subject to his face. You know, you're king, but really, you know you're king just because of a battle. I don't think that was brought up, and that was hurtful. And he could make you hurt, too, if you made him hurt. So if there was any question, there had to be some cleanup activity. And by cleanup activity, I mean there were some executions, yes. And this does seem like, doesn't it, like some of those mafia movies, and it's just like you got to wipe them all out. You know, somebody is lurking out there and might have a claim. Bring them on in. Hang them high, because there were some who were commoners, And then for the nobility who might have had Yorkist connections, you say, but those are his wife's family. Well, you know what they say about in-laws. So there you go. They get the chop chop. That's a sign of being high class. So, and that's not good. You know, I was speaking this morning to some of you about the technological advancement of the guillotine and how much nicer that was. I'm not sure I would like to try it out to prove that, but I've heard from individuals that made a great improvement over the old-fashioned head chopping, because they did bring in professionals from France. They had a head chopper school where people were trained, and you want to work on that blade beforehand to make sure gets it right every time, first time. Yep. So lots of bloodshed, and you think, gosh, after Bosworth Field, it looks like it would all have been about peace and love. No, not so much. Henry VII did not like any claimants running around loose. And so there were some who died. Here is one of them, and they always look so beatific, don't they? This poor soul was the son of Edward IV's brother, George. If you've heard of George, Duke of Clarence, you may have heard the story about how he died in the fermented beverage, and they just dropped him into a big pot. What a way to go, right? And so, gulp, gulp. This was his son, and this poor lad did nothing. He just happened to be the son of one of Edward IV's brothers. So in 1499, he had been in the Tower for years. I mean, I guess he was probably taking classes, you know, like we do, studying, just hanging out, because he was nobility, related to the Yorkist line and all of that. So, you know, he wasn't in a regular facility. But Henry VII just decided, you know, that it was time. So just one day, then he was beheaded. And again, here is the point. Here's a word I love. The Tudors were upstarts. We don't talk about upstarts much anymore, but if you know that word, you know it refers to people who don't have roots, who are not the old families. And the Tudors are definitely not an old family. Johnny come latelys. In other words, they've got to have more of a reputation for being around. And that is a very important point for both Henry VII and Henry VIII. Let's not forget that. The Tudors are definitely not long round. Bosworth Field, here come the Tudors. This was supposed to be them, I guess, in the style of a Holbein painting, perhaps. Whatever the case, she was very dutiful, and you know, it would be fascinating to wonder what she must have thought as her various family members were being executed and ended, and just having to accept the fact that this was all part of being a Tudor queen. But there it was. She did have the four children for him, and I think that look of, what shall we call it, sneakiness, Machiavellianism, whatever it was, bespeaks a mind of someone who was very clever and very wary, as well as someone who was highly interested in having more money. Yes, I promised trees today, and you are going to have your full share. All you've got coming. And I like this one because of the nice colors and pictures. I thought you deserve this instead of those long, nasty trees I normally put up. This one, as you can see, provides you with little pictures of them as they ruled, and you will see Arthur, Henry, and the lesser known daughters, which we will get to shortly, because they have a great deal of significance in terms of other family relationships. So for right now, just notice Margaret and Mary. And you'll see James I of Scotland down there, I promised you. Mm-hmm. In other words, the Stuarts as well as the Tudors will be able to trace their ancestry back. It's not a great claim. Some of you will remember that, for example, Henry VII's mother was a great-granddaughter of John of Gaunt by his third wife, and his father was a product of the Queen of Henry V by her alleged second husband. Weak, say you, and I agree. But there's something about winning in the battle and a dead king that makes you a little more powerful than all the trees in England. And that's the truth. That's just reality. But so far as that's concerned, the Tudors, 1485-1603, produce, as you can see, well, they give Lady Jane Grey credit, but we'll say five kings and a claimant, of course, for those who follow the Tudors, the Stuarts. Well, as you already know, most of you, story after story of this period will follow because of all these colorful individuals and all of the books, movies, and television shows that have come out about them, many of which I don't even know about or I haven't ever seen, but I know they're there for those who are interested. Henry VII has always been considered a great ruler, the first Tudor. I never have felt he got proper credit because we're so overwhelmed by his son. You know, it's almost like, yeah, Henry VII, I guess he's kind of significant. But it's almost like an afterthought. In fact, way back in the 50s and 60s, Henry VII began to be called the founder of modern English royal government. In other words, many of the institutions and the success of his development of bureaucracy and courts gave him, they said, much more claim to fame than he'd ever had. Later, some would take part of that back and say, well, he was good, but much of what he accomplished was based on what Edward IV had done before him. Whatever the case, he is still a major ruler, whatever his lust for money, which may have been an important cause for his governmental development, which is not a surprise, I wouldn't think, nor is the development of the Court of Star Chamber, which is an interesting device. The Court of Star Chamber was used to help people remember perhaps events that they had not been clear on before. So I think you understand that this was not a pleasant time. The Court of Star Chamber then was a way to enforce royal authority, shall we say, without any pesky rules or rights, and so, which can really be a drag when you are attempting to determine whether any of those Yorkists are still lurking around trying to steal my throne. In any event, he is, to give him his due, given credit for advances in government. Yes, the Parliament is still alive and well. However, there's not a lot new to report in that direction. There is a Parliament, but one senses that Parliaments are called after rigged elections so that people who attend those Parliaments will do what these Tudor rulers want. Now that will change a bit by the time of Elizabeth, but she didn't like it, and sometimes people would say something and they would end up spending a long weekend at the Tower of London. Maybe you want to rethink what you said, because there were problems. I mean, rulers do not like for people to talk against their decisions. It's just the way it is. It goes on. So this was hard. Now, Spain. Why Spain? Well, of course, Ferdinand Isabella. We are in that period, aren't we? Think 1492. And then remember, Bosworth Field, 1485. Now, that's not much time, what, 7 years? But during that time, the Tudors had taken rule. Ferdinand Isabella had married, and dynastically that created this kingdom of Spain, Aragon and Castile. That kingdom was a venerable one. We'll be discussing more about that. But at the present time, it's simply to note that they already had vast colonial interests in South America. And Henry VII, and I think he probably dreamt of gold in his sleep, you know. That was his idea of an erotic fantasy. Gold, you know. So it really turned him on, and he was thinking about, how could I get in on this? And you know the answer. Marriage. Yes. Marriage. They have daughters, and I have sons. Bingo. Nothing could be more beautiful. And you know where we're going now. Yes, Arthur and Catherine. So young, but it was definitely important. Now, let me again note that the death of that young Duke, who had spent so long in the Tower of London, and suddenly he was taken out and had his head chopped off. All of that preceded the negotiations for this marriage, because it was all to impress Ferdinand and Isabella. We're Tudors. We don't have any opponents. Or if we do, they're in purgatory. So basically, we're in charge. They've got to prove themselves to Ferdinand and Isabella. I just think it's interesting to note how insecure Henry VII must have been. Because I guess Ferdinand and Isabella did not want their daughter, at least one of their daughters, they had two, one of their daughters to be married to a ruler or an heir to a throne who might be in a very insecure position. So somehow they were convinced that Henry VII was really authentically accepted King of England, and they gave a big CC for the wedding. And that is, of course, Isabella and Ferdinand. And of course, as you know, this will be a very interesting union. A short one, but interesting nonetheless. It was a year or two, and yeah, and I mean, I think Arthur began, he was late teens, he was already demonstrating, he had not been terribly sick, but he'd never been especially well, and so by the time he was 18, 19, about this time, she was a bit younger, and I imagine she was taking English 101 and, you know, trying. You think about it, you know, it's like, it's tough, you know, to be Princess of Wales, and so you're studying the language and trying to connect to a husband. I don't think his Spanish was probably that good. So, I mean, it's tough. It's very tough, and especially when he doesn't feel good. So, you know, so yeah. So, at least they had Catholicism in common, so we can go to Mass. I mean, they got our Latin, Carol. Got our Latin. Don't never forget. No Spanish or English there. Okay, let's turn to other members of the family. And you say, well, when is Big Boy coming? Well, I'm saving him. but I want to talk about the daughters. Margaret of Scotland, it will be highly significant because as the wife of James IV, she will guide the government after his death when her son, James V, will be ruler. And of course, James V will be the predecessor of Mary, Queen of Scots, that we certainly know about. And so there will be important connections. And therein, of course, will lie Mary, Queen of Scots' relationship to the royal family. The other daughter is going to be interesting because, you know, it's, if your first marriage doesn't work out, poor Mary was married to an older French king who died on her. And so since there weren't any children, you're out of here, right? I mean, you know, go back home. So then she married someone to whom she was very devoted. Maybe they had been girlfriend, boyfriend before she got shipped off to France. Who knows? But they were very happily married. And her interest to us will have to do with the fact that they are grandparents, of course, of Lady Jane Grey. So there are these connections that I wanted to share with you as we get more and more into the story, because I just don't feel like we hear as much as we should about Margaret and Mary because we're so focused on the males. Stalin, it was said, went to a seminary before he became a member of the Communist Party. What connection could there be to our subject this afternoon? I think it has to do with Henry VIII being a student of theology and being very, very, I wouldn't say excited, but groomed to become the Archbishop of Canterbury. As the younger son, his father dreamt of having one son as Prince of Wales, going to be the new king, and I got the other son, the spare, so he will be the head of the English church. And again, when you want to dream at night, what could be a perfect world? This is part of that perfect world, along with this gold flow. To have, you know, one son Arthur run the state, the other son run the church. It's Tudor heaven, okay? It's going to be beautiful. Well, if it is true that Henry VIII was interested in theology, I guess we are not surprised that when he was around and his brother died suddenly as a young man, it must have been a tremendous shift. I mean, when you plan for a career in the as archbishop, and presumably he had a great interest in theology and religion, all that sort of thing. And I'll tell you why. As we will see, he tended to be a very, very active student. He was well-educated. He loved music. He loved poetry. But now, of course, he faced having to be king. And you'd love to know what that must have been like. Because he wasn't planning to get married. Because remember, we have a thing called clerical celibacy. So at least nominally, there will be no wife. There might be some special friends. But that's not marriage, believe you me. So, here we have a situation in which Henry was suddenly thrust from being future Archbishop of Canterbury to now being the heir to the throne. And here is where our gold comes in. Because remember, items like dowries can be refundable. You know, refundable. How could that be? Well, it hadn't worked out. He's dead. So we want, you know, we want a complete refund. I mean, Ferdinand and Isabel are going to say, oh, you just keep it. We're sorry it didn't work out. Just ship our girl home and we'll find her somebody else. And but yeah, we don't need that gold. We have plenty. Thanks. Grazie. But no, they really want that gold back. And Henry says, I just can't give it back. I love my gold. I love my gold. How can we work it out? Then you know the answer. We have another son. He is available. He's a growing boy. He's going to grow up one day, be a big boy, and we can just keep Catherine. She's doing great. She's acing her English language classes, and so she can just stay here and wait until he gets a little age on him, late teens. And so that means that this situation between Henry, the future Henry VIII, and Catherine of Aragon begins because of his father and his desire to keep that dowry. You just really have to wonder how these things affect history in such an amazing way. Now, it took 7 years. 7 years that Catherine would wait and say, oh gosh, you're getting really big. You must be working out, you know, because waiting for him to grow up, you know, it's tough on a girl, you know, to be engaged at, oh, I'm tired of girls, I'll hang out with the guys, you know, that kind of thing. But you know, they had to wait 7 years. And of course, there were some papers that had to be signed in Rome to make sure about that marrying the brother's widow. So we had to get some okays there. You know, bureaucrats, it takes time. Sometimes people need a little gratuity to get that paperwork through. So basically, it was an amazing process before they could actually be married. I mean, it's not as I guess we think sometimes, that it just happened right away. It took years. Henry had to grow up, and they had to clear all the paths.
How much difference was there in age between Arthur and Henry?
Oh, gee, I guess 6 or 7, maybe. Yeah, there was enough that he was young. Henry was younger than Catherine by several years, but that's not necessarily a problem. You just have to wait for him to grow up. So, but Henry wasn't going to let her go home. Well, honey, I bet you want to be with your mother and daddy. So we'll just say adios and you come on back with your gold when Henry grows up. No, no, no. You're staying here and keep up with your English lessons and I'll keep your gold. So he wouldn't, no. He was not going to let that gal go back to Spain. Not a chance. They wanted her there, and I'm sure those were difficult years for her, but anyway, so now they will become king and queen. Meanwhile, we know that Henry was in a certain way a devoted son of the church. In a term that is still used by Queen Elizabeth II, defender of the faith, Henry VIII took it upon himself to attack one sordid German named Martin Luther. Yes, Henry VIII, like his father, was devoutly Catholic, or their version thereof. In any event, the book, or the, well, it's not as much a book as a tract, I guess you would say, was an attack against Lutheran beliefs that only baptism and communion were really sacraments, that the other five are merely services of the church or that kind of thing. He did so in a way that the Pope, and in particular the current one who was a Medici Pope, some of you may know him, Leo X, just raved about Henry VIII, say, "You are wonderful. We appreciate this so much. This wild boar has entered our vineyard," as one papal tract will call Luther. And so I want you to sense that this young man, even if this was ghostwritten by Thomas More, which is one theory, and went under the name of Henry, still indicates that he was rah-rah Catholic, go Pope, you know, the whole business. And so it's not that he had read something by Luther and said, "Wow, I see a wonderful light of Christian purity. Down with Catholicism." I don't think so. He seemed very orthodox in his religious beliefs as a young man. Because if you'll notice the year and you'll remember, the 95 Theses were first expressed in 1517, only 4 years before. So this is moving on. Defender of the faith then is a title that they haven't given up, although I think the papacy may well have sent some letters and said they want a refund. I think that's been quite a long time that they have claimed that title. But it's interesting to note of its origins. Wolsey. Now, I gather that there is a series, somebody was telling me about it, about Thomas Cromwell. And so I guess Wolsey is portrayed. Wolsey has not gotten a good press over the years. But you know, Wolsey was a hardworking civil servant. I mean, he really, really did. He wasn't a nice person, I don't mean that. But he definitely worked hard. He was ambitious. He had enormous ideas of being the second English pope. So he campaigned actively. He was kind of an ecclesiastical Henry Kissinger, traveling about, making relationships, and one could see him as a great figure. And while there is not a democracy in Tudor England, people can work their way up. Wolsey, behind his back, was known as the butcher's son. I think we call that upstart, right? Because if anybody was an upstart, it was Wolsey. He basically worked his way up, probably because he was clergy, not seriously interested in religion, but he was definitely interested in the position, status, and wealth that could come to a man who had a variety of positions. And you see what it would lead him to. The red cap of a cardinal, the highest honor possible. All of this, while he was definitely not in the service of God, but, well, in his own service, but nominally in the service of the young King Henry VIII. And Wolsey is a very, very important person in this story, and I gather in the series too, because he had lots of individuals around him that he might have done well not to trust, because when the individual like this gets so much power, someone is just waiting to take it from them. Now, as I noted, Wolsey was not without his own ambitions. Certainly, he was serving the interests of King Henry VIII, but with the papacy a possibility, at least in his own mind. Now, honestly, I don't believe that after this time there was going to be a non-Italian pope until John Paul II. So, if he had known that, he could have saved his breath and not worried about it. But at that time, I don't think they realized how Italian-focused the papacy was going to be all those centuries. In any event, he was, I guess, in modern parlance, a player in international politics. And he had companions. I love that picture, Charles V as a young Habsburg emperor, and of course, the faithful dog. And of course, you see in him the Spanish qualities as well as others that would make him such an interesting figure. His counterpart was the Valois king, Francis I, who would also be a great international player, and Wolsey was involved with both of them. It will become a very interesting situation at a time, and again, let's go back to Henry, young Henry VIII. When young Henry VIII was enjoying poetry, theology, happily married, a variety of qualities with which we don't associate him, but he had Wolsey to do all the heavy lifting. And so, by and large, this particular period was one that gave Wolsey a lot of influence and power that he would not otherwise have enjoyed. I found this map because I just think it's so impressive to see all that Charles V ruled. Everything that you see colored. It's absolutely amazing when you think about it. The kingdom of Spain down there came to him because his grandparents were Ferdinand and Isabella. And remember, one of their daughters was Catherine of Aragon. The other daughter, Charles' mother, Joanna, was mentally unstable. Juana la Loca, as she was known. So this kingdom came to him through his grandparents. He had Italian territories, including Naples, Sicily. He had this area of what is Western France now. And in addition, Northern Italy, Switzerland, and most of Germany, as well as the Low Countries. You can understand that from the perspective of an English or French observer, there would be hope that Charles V would not be a success. It was a lot for one person to manage. And Charles V did his best. Oh, and did I forget to mention the Protestant Reformation? So if we don't have enough problems, the split in religion will create even more problems for Charles V. But it looks wonderful on paper. When you think of how he inherited that, he was a Habsburg through his father's side. And so that would account for the empire that you see up there. And of course, you see Aragon and all those lands. And then, of course, parts of what will become Italy. But to keep all that under one ruler, with all of the efforts of people like Henry VIII and Francis I to tear it apart, it's a very, very tough job. And when you see that white area, I'm sure you know that's Pope country, okay? Those are the papal states, and that's why that's white. And it doesn't mean Charles V's troops won't come through once in a while. And they no welcome wagon either, but they come, and that's a problem. And if you ever think, Charles V and the Pope must just love each other so much, it doesn't work out that way, but it seems like they should, doesn't it? You know, Emperor and Pope, nice combination, but they have their troubles. Oh, the king's great business. We don't have to want to bring up the ugly details, but let's just call it the great business. And that's what they will in diplomatic communications. Their marriage had been happy. Catherine, like many another faithful wife, had overlooked his numerous relationships with a multitude of females. And their marriage seemed to be happy during their younger years. But as she aged, she had had just one legitimate child. Well, one child who survived, and that was the girl Mary. There was a boy, but he was not legitimate. The question of legitimacy versus illegitimacy is not one that we need to worry too much about, because I don't think that they seriously considered trying to put him on the throne. The fact is, he wanted a legitimate son, and it was obvious that in her 40s, Catherine was not going to be that producer. And that was the king's great business. We now have a 5-minute intermission. Let me go back to poor Henry Fitzroy, because Henry Fitzroy is not known about, I don't even honestly know about his mother, but just say that she was one of the friends, and she produced a son. And I'll say this about Henry, he was really interested in all these children. They all got titles, so they all had a nice income and a nice marriages. Everything was fine. And if Henry, as he was growing up, thought, I wonder if Daddy could ever let me be king, I really doubt it because of the particular issues with the Tudors, and not to mention the particular concerns that Henry had by virtue of the fact that none of these children had been legitimized. But this does not mean he wasn't interested in him. He was. This is a depiction of Henry Fitzroy, which I doubt fits the circumstances of the 16th century. But he does not seem like a child who was told, well, you're illegitimate, so you'll have to go out in the fields and work. I know he was well provided for, but at a distance, and would not have been part of the royal succession. Meanwhile, Mary, growing up as the daughter of Catherine of Aragon and Henry, was fine, but Henry did not think that a female successor would work for the Tudors. That must have been his thought, to have done all that he would now do, despite the fact that if he had simply accepted her as his heir, much as some of you will remember Henry first did with Matilda, there might not have been the problems that there came to be. Now, some of you know of Mary Boleyn, the subject of various romantic novels and television shows and so forth. She was one of a long line of individuals who came in and out of Henry VIII's life. And it is interesting to me that she is a Boleyn, and one wonders if she was advisor to her sister on techniques in having affairs with powerful people. Whatever the case, Mary Boleyn was merely one of many. So, while a lot of books are written about her and all this and the other, I'm not sure that she had any special connection to power or that particular technique that would be necessary. But her younger sister did, and she made big time. Their father, Thomas, was one of many people at Henry VIII's court that I would consider, and this is the word for the day, upstart. Yes, definitely upstarts. Not unlike dear Cardinal Wolsey, Thomas Boleyn was an individual who worked his way up, and as he did so, he became involved on Henry's behalf in international diplomacy. I don't consider that to be so bad. I do consider to be somewhat bad using your own children to exploit a king and those particular concerns that will lead to your own success. But that seems to be the case with Thomas Boleyn, that he was fine with Mary, and that he encouraged Anne in her pursuit. Now, how is this done? My understanding has always been that it was done through insinuating these individuals into the queen's court, whether she liked it or not. In other words, the queen might not have the right of decision about whether or not an individual would be chosen. And from that particular angle, the individual could then pursue the king. So I don't want you to think that before the time of Anne Boleyn, the king had been maritally faithful. He had had many special friends, and the queen had had her share of pregnancies, but none leading to a child except for Mary. All of this then leads to the question of why Anne is different. Well, if you've seen the movies, and Lord knows I've seen them. And by the way, you go to the castle, 16 pounds, y'all, 16 pounds. You get to go through the gardens also, though. I looked up the latest rates. Okay, 16 pounds, that's a lot of money. So save up your money, and you can go and take a lot of pictures, get the t-shirt, buy the postcards, because Hever Castle is really nice. And if you want to get married over there or something, you can even rent it. But Hever is really, really lovely. And I shouldn't even get into this, but later on in the 20th century, it would become the home of the Astors, you know, when they moved over. You know, we just can't get enough of the English Americans. We just, so I guess if you're rich enough as an Astor, you just buy your way. So they had a home, they had Hever Castle. Because this has all the earmarks of the Nouveau family that the Boleyns were. I mean, they had this fabulous home where the Boleyn daughters were reared while Thomas was off representing Henry at the court of Francis, insinuating his daughters into court politics. But anyway, highly recommended on trips. Now, she is, as you see in the customary appearance of the time, and even as a very young woman, was quite aware of the opportunities that she might have. One assumes that by this point, Mary's time had come and gone. For those of you who studied these kings who have all these, you know, masses of individuals around them, you know, usually they have a time period and then they move on. You know, this has been great. I have a lot of good memories, and let's keep in touch, and there'll be a nice settlement, the check's in the mail, that kind of thing. I mean, you know, I think that's the way it had been with all these people. That's why we have bookkeepers and people who keep all of our records and all. They give out titles and pensions and this and that and the other. According to the sources, Anne Boleyn denied him her ultimate consent, and that is how she maintained his interest. That's the story I've heard, and I'm sticking to it. It seems so unlikely to me, but because of the, well, you know, he just had so many people, it just seems hard to believe that one person could have maintained this. But the stories tell us that for a long time she held him off, but they continued to quote-unquote date whatever that means. The language, our English language is changing very fast, folks. Very fast. And yes, let me take you back to Genevieve Bugeaud. Yes, I love that movie. I don't know what I thought about Richard Burton as Henry VIII, but I did love Genevieve. I'm not so sure that the real Anne Boleyn was as glamorous as Genevieve Bugeaud, but let's just say she was attractive, and whatever else, she certainly kept the attention of the king. During and after the, let's just wait, Henry, honey, or the period after. So, if that is the case, she was very bright and understood that she needed to wait her time. If the king was infatuated, I think that would probably be fair to say, and when she did consent, the pregnancy ensued rather quickly. And the result is, of course, biology tells us we've got that 9 months. We're on a schedule, okay? We've got to get married. I mean, that baby won't wait, will it? You can't say, put the baby on hold and just go on and wait. We've got a lot to get done before that baby's birth. Meanwhile, this all sounds very cold and calculating. Well, Henry himself wouldn't have agreed. So if he's in purgatory or else, he would probably say, wait, you don't understand. I'm a student of Scripture. And we were living in sin. I was married to my brother's widow. There was a womb cursing going on. That was the whole issue. What about Mary? Next question. You know, it's like the issue of Mary, notwithstanding, the whole argument about the child was one that could never be solved. But he was sticking to his theological arguments, and as such, he would proceed. And that's where the story really gets complicated. He had to assume, to make his argument, that Catherine and Arthur had really been married. So they have to pull out people who had worked for them to come to make testimony that, yes, that had been a legitimate marriage. Even though by now, Catherine, who was legitimately aware that this woman, Anne Boleyn, was a threat to her position and that of her own daughter, claimed, of course, that Arthur and she were never truly married. This then will become a crisis, and a crisis not only in England, but in Italy as well. Complicating the story will be the fact, of course, that Catherine of Aragon was related to the Holy Roman Emperor. Speaking of Juana la Loca, her son, Charles V, was the nephew of Catherine of Aragon. All of this, as we are going to see, will get very, very complicated. And it all started with just a special kiss between an adulterous king and a, shall we say, an adventuresome member of the queen's court. Wolsey, the butcher's son. Now you can earn that cardinal's cap and that archbishopric of York that I gave you. And you say, wow, did Wolsey like York? No, never been there. But he was archbishop because, you know, they have nice chicks and they come in. He was absentee archbishop of York. He had lots of that. He was abbot of Westminster. Yeah, because, you know, you need money to live like Wolsey was living, which was not exactly Christ-like. But now he's going to have a chance to show how valuable he is. So Wolsey is sent as special representative to the Pope. And the Pope is told, Your Holiness, the king begs you to understand that he is aggrieved that he married his brother's widow, and because of this terrible sin, he does not have a son. So the king, who loves you so much, and you know he is the defender of the faith, really ask you to consider, in your holiness, if you would annul the marriage. Just clear it out. There's not going to be any divorce. I hate it when people use that word, because it's not a divorce. He wants an annulment. You say, well, what does that do to the status of Mary? Well, we'll take care of that later. We're not going to worry about Mary. We just want to get out of this marriage. Because remember, the months are going by, as in nine tops. Okay, so I say, we are working on a time clock here. We got to get going. Because Anne is saying, what happened today, dear, in the proceedings? That sort of thing. So, yeah. And right now, you know, he's just, oh, you're so wonderful. How are you feeling? You know, all of that. See how long that lasts. Anyway, so Wolsey's in Rome, and the Pope goes, oh, my, my. This Pope, I think it's a beautiful portrait. It's Pope Clement VII. Pope Clement VII, in case you were wondering, is a younger cousin of Pope Leo X. And he is also a Medici. Those were those bankers. And sometimes, you know, the younger ones got interested in the church and decided that they would become members of the hierarchy. So he made it all the way up. He'd been a cardinal under his cousin, who was Leo X. Now he's Pope, and you say, well, that's great. Well, it could be if everything were going our way, but it isn't. We are now going through the aftermath of Martin Luther. These are not good times to be Pope. I mean, you've got a lot of problems. You've got the Lutherans, and before long, you're going to get Calvin causing troubles. So you got all of that. You say, well, I know that's bad. That's not all of it. There's more. You also have Charles V. And you'd say, but Juana Laloca's son should be a devoted son of the church. Yeah, right. But he wants power in Italy. Briefly, before all of this, Charles V's troops, I don't think Charles V did this deliberately, but they were his troops, had actually visited Rome, pillaged and sacked the city. And you say, well, is this a Muslim army? Or are these Protestants? No, they're all Catholics. They're all probably drinking And they probably looking for souvenirs they don't want to pay for, you know. You know, gift shops can be rather costly. So, all in all, Clement VII probably did not want to cross Charles V. They'd already had their run-in. That's part of it. Because otherwise, the theory is, Clement VII would have been all over Cardinal Wolsey and said, I would love to get this annulment. Let me call the secretary and have one fixed up and I'll sign it. Put my seal on it. In ordinary circumstances, but these were far from ordinary circumstances. So he said, I need to think about this some more, I really do, because, I mean, when you married Catherine, you know, the Pope before me approved it, so seems pretty legitimate, but I'm sure you have some good arguments, so here's what I'm going to do. At Clement, he was cagey. He said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to send back another of my cardinals with you. You go back to England and you can hear testimony. Then we'll decide. You say, is this delaying? I think it is. I definitely think it is. Now here's my second tree. This is the short one. It's merely to show you how Charles V is connected to Isabel, connected to Catherine, rather, and whether or not aunt and nephew, if that really makes the great difference, it's certainly got an important connection when you think about the love of cousins. That's coming very soon, yes. As we have seen so often in this course, family ties are very great. And so Philip and Mary are going to be an interesting combination, as we will see later on. But for right now, it's simply the idea that Clement VII would have liked to have been accommodating and said, sure, annulment, I'll run it off. Does the king maybe want to make a contribution to the Roman Orphans Fund or something? You know, that kind of thing. You drop the lira in the box, and then the annulment's gone. Wolsey's headed for England. But it can't happen because the Pope is concerned about Charles V. So that's where we are in that situation. This is the seal of the individual that Clement VII entrusted with hearing testimony, with the very Italian name Campeggio. Cardinal Campeggio, one of Clement's men, he said, you know, I really trust Campeggio, so I'm going to send him back with you, Pole. I know you can show him, Wolsey, excuse me. You and Wolsey, and you all can hear testimony. And I've often wondered if Wolsey suspected a trap or he knew that he was, I don't think I would have liked to go back and see my boss, you know, and say, gee, I'd hope that we would have an agreement, but he said, gosh, it's 4 months, it's 5 months, tick-tock, we got, you know, biology. But anyway, so he brought him back, and Campeggio plays the game. He says, oh, I just want to hear the testimony and let everybody have their say. We want to be fair. I mean, this is a church's decision. So, and I think maybe when you think about Campeggio having his instructions, and we do know that he did have instructions to slow it down, I guess perhaps Clement thought that maybe with some marital counseling that Henry and Catherine will have a big kiss and then you can come back to Rome and everybody will be happy. Who knows? But Campeggio was to stall. And as far as I am aware, Cardinal Wolsey was told none of this. Could you imagine if he had been? I mean, Wolsey was a king's man, and so the Pope had no interest in telling the king about his plans. So that's Cardinal Campeggio. And I love this painting, and some of you may have seen this in movies or other, in the most dramatic scene from the action, you can see the queen more or less pleading in vain that she has been the faithful wife to the king and that there is no reason for their marriage to end. Now, this is definitely not something that could have made Cardinal Wolsey too happy. And I'm not sure that the Queen was allowed to attend this court session afterwards. But it's certainly very dramatic and probably very uncomfortable for everyone except maybe Henry. But at this particular point, I think due to the time, again, you know, we're getting close to the baby, and due to the circumstances, Henry is tired of all of this foolishness, in his view. So basically he says, proceedings are basically over, and the marriage is not true. My marriage to Catherine of Aragon was not right. Campeggio can go back to Rome. And Wolsey, I'll see you in private. Yeah, it's been real. But you can assume that this is not going to last. Now, this is an interesting fellow. This was the special deputy of the cardinal, a fellow with the interesting name of Thomas Cromwell. And I am told by some very intelligent people that he is now being portrayed as a rather attractive person. I've never heard of such revisionism, but we'll do anything for good ratings, I think. In any event, this is my Thomas Cromwell. I'm sorry. Not exactly a Hollywood dreamboat, but they tell me that he was a very hard man. And he followed Wolsey as long as Wolsey was around, and did as much of his dirty work as needed to be done. I'm sure that in many ways he was like Wolsey, except I don't think he was as degenerate or perhaps as enslaved, as the prayer book would say, to the world, the flesh, and the devil, as Wolsey was. I mean, I think probably Cromwell was ambitious, but he was prepared to, in single-minded fashion, to follow the will that would help his own career. Wolsey was disgraced, and again you say, well, that just seemed like Henry was an ingrate. Well, he was very grateful as long as things worked. But he's no longer, they're not working. So Wolsey's a failure and needs to die. So it seems interesting to me. And of course, who knows what late medieval health conditions were like. I would doubt that God knows it was following a health regimen. You know, I think maybe a bit too much red meat. Who knows? But whatever the case, Wolsey died before he could be executed, which is nice. Once he was disgraced, the funeral would be held at York, which I think is kind of ironic because he'd never been there before. But it's like he was archbishop, so they said, why don't we have the service here? There's a little bit of irony in that. And I guess that's better than having your head chopped off. But Wolsey was definitely out, and Cromwell now would definitely be in. As far as I am aware, this is one of the many artistic works of Hans Holbein, who is one of the great painters of the period, and some of you who know about art will recognize the style. It's interesting that now he will turn to a lay person instead of a cleric. I don't know if that's by design or whether it had any significance at all. I just know that, at least in the version that I know, he was a cold-blooded person who was determined to fulfill the king's will, and he was willing to do whatever he needed to do. The king's great business then will proceed by having a clergyman involved, and this, of course, will be Thomas Cranmer, best known to many of us because of the Book of Common Prayer, still used in the Episcopal Church, and Church of England, of course. An Oxford professor who, conveniently enough, came along with a point of view just when the king needed him. The old Archbishop of Canterbury had actually died by this point, and if I'd been he, I would have wanted to die too. I mean, this is a good time to die. If you're already old and you've got Henry VIII breathing down your neck, say, wait a minute, do you agree with me or do you agree with the Pope? And say, well, you both are mighty fine people. And think, oh, I'm not feeling well. Well, I wouldn't either. Yeah. So at that point, the Archbishop of Canterbury, and he will be approved by papal authority. I always think that's interesting. He is an Oxford Don named Thomas Cranmer. And as far as I'm aware, he sincerely and devoutly believed that in this case, the king's argument about the legitimacy of Arthur's marriage to Catherine was true, which means that, according to the new Archbishop of Canterbury, the king's marriage to Catherine of Aragon was null and void. And Cranmer earned, I suspect, a bonus that year for carrying out the king's will. Because again, that marriage didn't come a moment too soon. You know how some of you remember when people say, oh, and she was showing, you know, and that sort of thing. So I'm thinking, so you understand that it was time for that marriage. There wasn't a lot of time to wait. So Catherine, well, she'll be taken care of. She and her daughter, they'll be provided for, no hard feelings. She'll get a special title and checks, and we'll stop in and check in, see if y'all doing well, and wish you all the best. These have been some good times. I really appreciate everything you've done. Hasta luego and all of that, you know. So she's off to spend a life basically alone in her religious practices. As now, the king proceeds, he hopes, with his new queen and his real wife, so he says, Anne Boleyn. And he goes on to choose the man about whom so much has been written and studied, Sir Thomas More, and he becomes the chancellor. It is said that More did not want the job, but whether or not that he did, it is odd that he did. He was offered it because I guess he was a great scholar and he was a well-known authority. But at the same time, for reasons that people have commented on so often, More could not accept the king's marriage to Anne Boleyn. And thus, the great movie, the Academy Award-winning great movie, with, and I think Wendy Hiller was just magnificent, but the movie, A Man for All Seasons, clearly makes More a great hero by his denial of royal commands for moral reasons, and this statement that the play suggests is a very, very beautiful one. How much it is true, it's hard to say, but More did give his life for it because he will be executed because Henry will decide there is one way, my way, and that way is the way of accepting my marriage to Anne Boleyn, the children from that marriage, as well as a renunciation, essentially, of the Pope or Bishop of Rome. Dowager Princess of Wales. That's a nice title, but it's not, it's definitely a demotion if you had been queen. Whether or not, it's interesting though that her life was never in danger. I don't know if she was free to leave England, I doubt it. But I think that more or less there in her home, she was probably watched, but she was maintained. She was never a threat. She always, of course, maintained her Roman Catholic faith. On the other hand, she was no longer in power. And she had to be aware, of course, that this upstart Anne Boleyn was now queen, and Anne Boleyn, by that point, had a child. Our concern now is the fact that Mary, Catherine's daughter, is older, and Anne Boleyn's child is also a female. Is there a problem? Yes, there is, but Anne is young. And despite the fact that Anne's not the pleasant person we thought before we married, maybe a boy will be arriving soon. She says she's very fertile, and the doctors all said she's quite fertile. So I think we just have to wait, and boys will start arriving very soon. Well, unfortunately for all concerned, that was not the case. So I think I'm going to leave it there, and please come back for more Tudor history right here next week. Thank you.